My guest is a comedian, poet, playwright, musician, actor, director, and author. He began performing comedy in 1971, later going on to work as a director and to write for radio and TV as well as the theatre. In 2005, he decided to retire from theatrical work of any kind and went off with a bike and a tent. And now he's back. He is John Dowie.
Hello.
Hello, John. You're back and you're back with a book.
I'm back with a book. I've dropped my bike. I left the tent behind. I brought a book.
Right. And the book is The Freewheeling John Dowie, which I've read and thoroughly enjoyed.
Good.
In which you kind of tell it all, do you?
Well, it's about going camping and biking and then reminiscing about various things that happened before I went camping.
And
in showbiz, the world of showbiz.
In showbiz. Showbiz before and after.
Yeah.
Right. Well, I suggest, why don't we...
Read a bit,
so we get an impression of
get where
you
get a chance to think, well, I'll turn over and watch something else. My comedy career began in 1971, which proves I have no comic timing. In 1971, there were no comedy clubs, no comedy agents, and not much comedy future. There was, however, the Edinburgh Festival Fringe. I went there aged 21, making my professional debut and getting my first review, a bad one, Fatuous, the Scotsman. But a bad review was hardly surprising. Comedy requires practice, and with venues being almost non-existent, practice was hard to find. But I persevered. Why? We don't know. I persevered doing gigs where I could in folk clubs, music venues, fringe theatres, universities, and rooms above a pub. Things improved. By the end of the decade, I was working regularly and earning a living. In the 1980s, alternative comedy arrived, and with it, more gigs, more money, and a lot more comedians. By the 1990s, comedy was big business, about to get even bigger. It was then, with yet more comic timing, that I packed it all in. It was as though my departure was just the break that comedy was waiting for. No sooner had I stopped than comedians were earning vast amounts of money performing in venues the sizes of small countries. I, meanwhile, was in a different sort of venue, a one-man tent. How did this happen? It happens because I have, I've been told, an addictive personality. This doesn't mean that once you get to know me, you'll find me endlessly fascinating. It means that once I get hold of something I like, I do it to death, which is what happened when I bought a bike. I thought I could handle it. I'll just have the occasional ride, I told myself, perhaps at weekends or when I feel stressed. What a joke! Soon I was having bike rides before breakfast. It got worse. The more rides I took, the more rides I wanted.
Well, let's start at the beginning. I mean, it was your choice to stop.
It was.
But let's go back earlier on when you just started. You often describe it as a Elvis moment when you met someone who inspired you very much. Do you want to tell me about that?
Well, that was Spike Milligan, who was in the early mid-60s. He was touring a play called The Bed-Sitting Room, which I went to see, and I hadn't really had much interest in comedy or anything beforehand, but I went to see this play that Spike Milligan was in and treating as a vehicle for ad-libbing and so forth. And it was like people say about Elvis, when they heard Elvis, they became rock and roll performers, and it was the same with me when I saw Spike Milligan.
You just saw him and you thought, wow, this is going to change my life.
Now I can do something I want to do. Because I was 18 at the time, and I was 16. And I just left school, and, you know, and growing up in Birmingham in the mid-1960s, you think, well, what do I do? You know, I mean, if there was a war on, that'd be all right, they'll give you an occupation, but there's nothing happening at all. And then I saw Spike Milligan and thought, oh, that's what I will do. I will do.
But you didn't have any wish to do it before? It was literally...
Well, I used to kind of, in a way, because what I was doing was being very amusing at the expense of my teachers in school.
Right.
Hiding their trousers during gym was a favourite activity.
And you mentioned one of your teachers at...
Well, there was another teacher who was actually very helpful to me, called Mr. Britton, who treated his children, his pupils, with respect, and encourage them in what they wanted to do rather than telling them what they ought to be doing, which is what most... I mean, I remember one school at lunchtime, we were listening to some classical music on a gramophone record player, and I was imitating the singer, some tenor woman, and to make my friends laugh, and the teacher came over and, to show his love of classical music, smacked me in the face.
Those were the days.
Oh, yeah. But also, he said, well, if this is what classical music does to you, it enables you to beat small boys, well, maybe I won't take any interest in classical music. So, yeah, Mr. Britton was a very influential, not just to me. I mean, there must be hundreds of kids out there that were influenced by and helped by him. That's what people forget about good teachers. They have a massive influence that goes on, you know.
Of course.
A long way.
So that's when you started stand-up comedy. Is it fair to say that you are the pioneer of alternative stand-up comedy?
The pie and chips of alternative comedy. No, I just happened to be doing it before other people started doing it, that's all.
That's the definition of being a...
Well, yeah, but it wasn't like follow me, you know. Right. I was just doing what I wanted to do, and then later on more people came along and wanted to do it.
And a lot of people have mentioned you as an inspiration.
Yeah.
Well,
I'm not responsible for their wet dreams.
But then you decided to stop a while later.
Yeah.
Did you enjoy stand-up comedy when you were doing it?
Not really, because a lot of the time I was doing it in places where people didn't want it, you know, like supporting a rock band, for example. And a rock band audience, if they don't like an act, will make their position very clear, you know, often physically. So quite often it was... There were occasional performances that were enjoyable, but not particularly. I mean, I don't particularly like performance. I don't like doing this.
No?
But I've got to do something to... Buy my book. Please buy my book.
So I suggest let's watch something from back in the day and see you in action, shall we?
OK.
I don't eat meat or fish. I'm what's known as a smug bastard. And every now and then, much against my will, I have to go into a vegetarian restaurant. I hate those places. Why do I hate them? Because they're full of vegetarians. People who can't go out and eat without wearing leg warmers. And when you go into a vegetarian restaurant, you don't just go in there, eat the food and leave. Too easy. You've got to read the walls as well. And you always have the same stuff written on the walls.
A little bit aggressive, is it? Are you a little bit nasty in your comedy?
Used to be, yeah. Yeah, very nasty.
Right.
Very nasty. The Adolf Hitler of stand-up, they used to call me.
Is that right?
No, I just made that up. But.
OK, so you clearly had enough of comedy.
Well, I think more or less comedy had enough of me.
Do you think so?
Well, I think it was time to stop. But I've got two little children, and they were my priority at that time. And you can't leave your kids behind and go off and entertain a room full of strangers and come back and expect... Also, if you're a comedian, all you're going to do is end up making fun of your own children, as I've noticed. So I'm quite glad that so are they.
Which they probably didn't mind when they were little, but afterwards...
Well, they would have minded it.
OK. But
so we moved to Brighton and put my focus on them.
Let's hear a little bit about Brighton, shall we?
Yeah, I moved to a suburb of Brighton called Preston Park.
Mm-hmm.
And there was a pub there which I used to visit regularly, and I became, for the first time in my life, one of the pub regulars. The regulars were a bunch of middle-aged men, and some of them were men with the cruelest sense of humour. Chris the Pill, a pharmaceutical salesman, had remembered to buy his eggs and his bacon, but had forgotten the bread. After some swearing, he left the bacon and eggs on the bar and went back up the hill to the bakery. This gave Nick the nurse. Nick the nurse was a nurse. This gave Nick the nurse plenty of time to take the eggs into the pub's kitchen, hard boil them, put them back in their box, back on the bar, then stand around with the rest of us. Chris the Pill came back, finished his pint, then went home to cook his breakfast. No one said anything. 15 minutes later, Chris the Pill came back into the pub and said quite a lot. Roger the alcoholic, an alcoholic, came in one day sporting a black eye. How did you get the black eye, Roger? I fell asleep in a bottle bank and somebody put one in. Through it all, standing like a pipe-smoking rock, was Norman. Norman had turned 80 more than a few years ago, and his house was at the top of a long and steep hill. Nevertheless, every day he'd insist on walking home, despite our urging him to take a taxi. It's less than the price of a pint, Norman, I'd say. I know, said Norman, but all the old biddies who live on that hill all know where I've been. And the disapproving looks on their faces as I walk past their twitching curtains is the only thing that keeps me going. Every time Norman left the pub, someone would say, I hope I'm like Norman when I'm his age. And every time they did, I would say, I just wish I was like that now. Dear old Norman, gone.
So these are the Brighton days?
The Brighton days, yes, I enjoyed the Brighton days.
And in fact, it was because of, or thanks to your children, that you decided to stop, is that right?
As I said earlier, I couldn't function as a stand-up comedian when I've got two new people in my life who have different priorities than being the son of a comedian. Can you imagine anything more horrible in your life? What does your dad do? He's a comedian.
I can, but never mind. After the break, we'll come back to talk about children, not necessarily yours, but your input to children's entertainment.
Oh, good.
Welcome back. John Dowie is with me. John,
how do you know I'm not against you?
I don't know.
You don't know?
And I'm a little bit worried, actually. Children, I have noticed throughout the book, even though people, including yourself, say that you're hateful and bitter and twisted, there is a very, very soft, very loving and affectionate approach to children.
Good, good.
And one of the things that you have written, together with a Brightonian, Tony Hauser?
Tony Hauser, yeah.
Is Dogman.
Dogman, a show
for
children.
Tell me about Dogman. Before you read anything, just tell me, who is Dogman?
Dogman is a strange person who mysteriously appears in a lighthouse and makes friends with a couple who run the lighthouse.
He's not quite a person, is he?
He's a half-man. Well, when he meets people, he says, I'm half-man, half-dog, you know. And they say, don't tell me, is your name Dogman? He goes, yes. How on earth did you know? Yeah, and his object in life is to make friends with everybody and get them to play together nicely.
And did you write or co-write Dogman for your children necessarily?
Pretty much. Yeah.
And they liked it.
Yeah, they did. Yeah. Well, they may have been lying.
May have been.
Oh, we loved it, Dad.
Let's hear a little bit about Dogman.
Well, what happened with Dogman, there's so many good things that happened doing the Dogman show, and I deeply regret the fact that I can't do it anymore because I am far too old. And we did we took Dogman, we did it in Brighton, and then we did it in London, and then we took it to Edinburgh, and then we did a few shows here and there, and then it went away. Before we took Dogman to Edinburgh, this explains why I stopped being a stand-up comedian, perhaps. Mm-hmm. Before we took Dogman to Edinburgh, I had a problem with the show and I didn't know how to fix it. During one of the London performances, I read the thoughts of a father, a black man, sitting in the front row. His son, aged about 4, was sitting on his lap, and this is what the father was thinking. You've got a nice show here. I like it, my son likes it. But would it have killed you to have had a black face on the stage? I didn't want Dogman's audience to think that he lived in an all-white world. Nor did I want to lose a member of the Dogman cast because of the colour of their skin. I didn't know what to do, but sometimes fate will lend a fortuitous hand. The white-skinned actress, Susie Aitchison, was not available for the Edinburgh run. The black-skinned actress, Vicky Licorice, was. Vicky joined the show. My problem was solved. At the end of the performances in Edinburgh, it had become my habit to hang around by the stage as, quite often, children would not leave the theatre without saying goodbye to Dogman. After one performance, a woman holding... We're going to start crying now. After one performance... We're all going to start crying now. After one performance, a woman holding the hands of 2 small girls, one black, one white, came to the front of the stage and beckoned to Dogman. I went over. She said, could we have a word with Vicky Licorice? I said, sure, then went backstage. Vicky was about to change, but followed me back into the auditorium, still in her costume. I stood to one side as a little girl aged about 5, who, I am fairly certain, was either fostered or adopted, and who almost certainly was the only black child in the audience that day, looked up at Vicky and said to her, you look like my mum. There aren't many people who enter the world of showbiz in order to become an abject failure. The more usual goals are glittering success, fame and fortune. I have nothing against fame or fortune. How could I? I've never experienced either. But if during the course of my glittering showbiz career, I was able to help a small child feel a little less lonely, even if for only 60 fleeting minutes, then that is as much success as I will ever want or need. and it would seem a fitting place for a comedy career to end.
Aww. You see?
And then he died.
No. You do have a nice, soft side to you.
Yeah, that's the vulnerable position. That's where they put the knife. And the underbelly.
That was Dogman, and then you had another adventure, not that long afterwards. Mm. It was resurrected at some stage.
Strange word to use.
And that was your play.
Yeah, Resurrection.
Jesus, My Boy.
Jesus, My Boy, yeah, one-man play. About the father of Jesus, the earthly father of Jesus, Joseph the carpenter, who was, I was engaged in fatherhood at the time, so obviously I'm going to be thinking about fatherhood things.
Jesus' father, Joseph, was not a very good carpenter.
Not a very good carpenter. Don't talk to me about wood. This was his expression. You're trying to make it one thing, it turns into another, it splinters, it breaks when you least expect it to, it snaps all the time, it's impossible to deal with. Did I say wood? I meant children.
And that's a very, what's the word, probably respect, you know, it's a subject that it could be dangerous to touch, from that kind of perspective, but you're very respectful, I think.
I'd like to be. Because the thing about the play was when I was writing it, I started off thinking I'd write a lot of jokes, but then they think, well, yeah, but it's all really well writing a lot of jokes, but at the end, one of the characters gets crucified.
So it's a bit...
We wring the humour out of that.
There is humour, and it is quite...
But people in adverse circumstances often turn to humour.
Yes, that's very true. And then something special happened when you performed it yourself in London.
I was performing it in London, and a little boy put his head round the dressing room door. I say the dressing room door, it's the kitchen. Put his head round the door and said, are you Jewish? I said, not yet. And it turned out to be a Jewish comedian called Gil Kopach.
Not a little boy, but a young man.
Well, a young man.
He's famous in Israel.
Very famous in Israel, I was very pleased to learn. And he translated it into Hebrew and performed it himself and invited me to Israel to see it.
And you did, you went.
I did, and I'll tell you something, it was one of the best things that's ever happened to me, yeah.
In what way?
Well, being in the Holy Land for a purpose, rather than just being there as a tourist, was quite a nice thing to feel. And I liked the country and the people who lived in it. And it was good, I just felt good to go there.
Shall we hear a little bit about that?
Well, there's
experience?
A story, yeah. When I was in Israel, I spent about 3 or 4 days there, and Gil and his sister took me to various parts of it to look at, touristy type places. One of which was, where is it? It was near Tel Aviv, and it was supposed to be the place where Christ had done his celebrated Sermon on the Mount.
Right, in Jerusalem, wasn't it?
I thought it was Capernaum. Copernicum.
Right.
Yeah, and there's a building called the Church of the Beatitudes, because the speech he did is called the Beatitudes, which is situated on a hill near Capernaum. The church has been built to commemorate the spot where Jesus is supposed to have given the Sermon on the Mount. So I looked at this church and I looked at the spot and I thought, well, he wouldn't do it here. It's not centre stage. Centre stage is in a position on the stage where everybody's focus is. And where this damn church was built was not actually centre stage. Centre stage was further down the hill. I said to Gil, this wasn't where it happened. It would be down there. So I said, let's go see. So I grabbed hold of Gil by the arm. This isn't centre stage, I said. What, said Gil? But I was gone by then, walking away from the church and further down the hill towards a flat piece of land that overlooked the valley below. Gil stood to one side as I walked to the spot where, over 2,000 years ago, a man may or may not have given a speech that would resonate through the centuries. I looked at the land below me, imagining the upturned faces of the crowd, all eyes focused on this exact spot. Then I stood aside and Gil took my place. He stood for a moment in silence and stretched out his arms, lifted his face to the sky, and danced in a small but perfect circle. On the hill above us stood a church, a mighty structure of marble and gold, standing in a space that could only have been, at best, the dressing room to which Christ and his supporters would have retired to drink wine, discuss the performance, and ignore the notes given by an uncredited director. Below the church, the bitterness is there. Below the church, on the humble patch of land where Jesus may actually have spoken, where I stood, and where my good friend Gil Kopach danced, there stands another commemorative structure. It is a tree, a solitary tree.
Mm.
Here endeth the lesson.
John, after all these productive things, you've taken a bicycle and off you went. What does it do to you to cycle? You obviously don't miss performing, otherwise you would have done it. But what does cycling actually do for you?
It gives me the freedom to think in peace and quiet. And it doesn't matter where you are. If you don't like where you are, it doesn't matter, because you'll be somewhere else in a little while. And then you can pitch your tent and have something to eat and drink some wine and get up next day and do it all again. And just go from place to place and enjoy your own company, which some people are frightened of doing.
Yes, yes.
A lot of people aren't happy unless they're in somebody else's company. Well, I've got news for you, baby, you know.
Right.
One day you will be all alone and you better get used to it.
Okay, and you're getting used to it, but you've produced this fantastic book.
Thank you, fantastic book.
Very, very good read.
Thank you.
John Dowie, thank you so much.
Thank you for having me.
And good luck in the future.
Thank you.
Goodbye.